Dear Hind children, welcome in your history class. Let us revise the chapter, The National Movement, the First Phase. By the mid of the 19th century, there was a feeling of nationalism, you can say that. It was arousing among the people. So what were the factors which led to the rise of nationalism? We are going to discuss that. Okay. So in the second half of the 19th century, led to a political awakening among the people. There was a growth of national consciousness and consequently a new kind of movement took shape. Then rise of nationalism, children. The strengthening of a common national identity gave rise to an organized national movement in India. It was national in character as it represented the aspirations of the Indian people as a whole. Now the people started looking beyond their regional boundaries and thought of India as a single nation and themselves as a part of this nation. So with this growing sense of unity came the feeling of nationalism. So what do you mean by nationalism? A feeling of collective belongingness which we feel towards our own country, children. So now we are going to see the factors which contributed to the rise of nationalism in India. Number one is discontent against British rule. You know that British exploited India, isn't it? So all sections of society, they suffered under British rule. The peasants had to pay high taxes. The artisans was ruled by foreign competition. And even the factory workers received very low wages. Children, the British made no attempt to encourage agriculture and industry. They treated India as a source from where raw materials could be obtained cheaply and as a market which could absorb British goods. Employment opportunities for the educated Indians were very, very limited. And India was made to pay for the upkeep of the British army and for the wars that Britain fought, children. So, the first factor is the Britishers, they were exploiting India and all sections of society where they were suffering under British rule. Taxes jada dena padta tha, then their factory workers ko bahut kam wages milti thi, and the Britishers ne agriculture industry ko barbaad kar diya tha. Britishers ke India sirf ek source tha raw material ka and market tha unke finished goods ka. Then the second factor, Britishers, they were just draining India's wealth, and which increases poverty in India. They were frequent famines, drought per day, and which was a sign of poverty. It was an indication of poverty, children. And Britishers, they always make us feel that they are superior because they were white, and we Indians are inferior because we are black. So the British considered themselves a superior race and the Indians as belonging to an inferior bunch of it. The certain hospitals and parks were reserved for Europeans. Even children, you know that in trains, some compartments were reserved for the white people and Indians were not allowed to travel in them. So all these factors resulted in growing opposition to British rule. Then the second factor was political, administrative and economic unification of the country. India was unified under British rule as one unit. The British introduced a uniform system of governance throughout the country. Laws were uniformly applied to all. Economic life in India became interlinked after the introduction of modern industries. So people from all parts of the country worked in these industries. So while working and traveling together, children, caste, community and regional feelings began to weaken. A feeling of solidarity and togetherness developed when the railways, telegraph and postal system helped people to come in contact with one another. People realized that British rule was responsible for their suffering. So this anti-British feeling, it was a major factor that contributed to the rise of nationalism, children. Then comes spread of modern education. Modern education also helped the rise of nationalistic feelings. The British had introduced modern Western education to prepare some Indians to work at low post in the administration. The British also believed that if Indians were exposed to Western thoughts and ideas, they would become supporters of British rule in India. The British expected that since educated Indians would be dependent on them for employment, they would always remain loyal to them. But children, things did not turn out as the British had expected. Exposure to Western ideas, many people were conscious of their rights and they were very impressed by the ideas of freedom and equality popularized by the American and French revolutions. Now they started criticizing the government for suppressing these ideas in India and denying basic human rights to Indians. The English language acted as a unifying factor because people from different parts of India speaking different languages now could communicate with one another through a common medium, and that common medium was English. So educated Indians acquired a democratic and nationalistic outlook. And the other factor that played an important role in spreading nationalism in India is role of the press. The Indian press played an extremely important role in strengthening national consciousness. The newspaper of the period highlighted the anti-Indian policies of the British government and asked the people to unite and work for a common cause. Both the English and the vernacular press became a medium to mobilize public opinion and create a feeling of national bonding. The government tried to suppress the growing feeling of nationalism and patriotism by banning newspapers and books. These attempts, children, however, failed. The works of scholars and writers like Bankim Chand, Rabindranath Tagore, Subramanya Bharati, Bhartendu Harishchand, and others were also important in arousing national consciousness. Their nationalist literature, in the form of fiction, essays, and patriotic poetry, developed self-confidence in the masses. There were some immediate factors also, children. By the 1870s, the spirit of national identity had taken deep roots in the minds of the people. The policies of the Viceroy, Lord Lytton, intensified discontent against British rule. He removed import duties on British goods and it ruined the textile industry of India. So the policies of Viceroy Lord Lytton intensified discontent against British rule. He removed import duties on British goods, which ruined the textile industry of India. He made India pay for the war. He made India pay for the war against Afghanistan. In 1877, when India was suffering from a famine drought, a lavish imperial darbar was held in Delhi. A large amount of money was wasted on it. Then the Vernacular Press Act of 1878 was passed to it. So the Vernacular Press Act of 1878 imposed restrictions on vernacular newspapers. The Arms Act of 1878 forbid Indians from possessing arms. So both these acts, means Vernacular Press Act of 1878 and the Arms Act of 1878, aroused strong reactions from all sections of the society. Then comes Elbert Bill controversy. In 1883, Lord Ripon's law member, Sir Elbert, he introduced a bill which later came to be known as the Elbert Bill. It had a provision which gave Indian judges the power to try cases involving Europeans. Immediately, the whole European community started an agitation opposing the bill. This protest forced the government to withdraw the bill, children, and to the Indians, it was a proof that they could never expect equality from the British government. So these were the factors which gave rise to nationalism in India, children. Then comes the formation of political associations. After the 1850s, Indians began to form political associations to work for their own welfare. And one of the first such associations was the British Indian Association. It was formed by Surendranath Banerjee in 1851. In 1852, the Bombay Association and the Madras Native Association were set up. So many associations were set up in the 1870s and the 1880s. They included the Pune Sarvajanik Sabha, the Indian Association, the Madras Mahajan Sabha, and the Bombay Presidency Association. All the associations formed were limited in both membership and agenda. So most of the members were educated Indians belonging to the upper sections of society. They sent petitions requesting the government to reduce taxes, end discriminatory practices, introduce administrative reforms, and give Indians a greater role in administration. The petitions were ignored by the government, and the activities of these associations were also restricted to specific regions. The need for an All India Association, which was mass-based and strong in putting up its demand, had been felt for a long time. In Surendranath Banerjee, he brought people from all over India, and for the first All India National Conference held in Calcutta in 1883. Then comes Indian National Congress. While Surendranath Banerjee was busy in organizing the conference at Calcutta, a retired British official, A.O. Hume, he called a meeting in Bombay. He wanted to create an association which would be under the supervision of the British and which would let the government know the demands of the Indian people. He wanted to prevent another nationwide outbreak like the one that took place in 1857. So A.O. Hume was in support of an association which would be under the supervision of the British and which would let the government to know the demands of the Indian people. So the meeting convened by A.O. Hume was held at Gokuldas Tejpal Sanskrit College from 28 to 30 December 1885, and this became the Indian National Congress. It was attended by 72 delegates from all over the country. They included many eminent leaders such as Umesh Chandra Banerjee. And you know that Umesh Chandra Banerjee was the first president of the Indian National Congress. Dadabhai Nauroji and Firoz Shah Mehta, Bahadur Tayyab Ji, many others. The Congress had very modest beginnings. It held its session in different parts of India. Once a year, for the first few years, many Englishmen were also involved in its activities. So in the early years, the main aims of the Congress were, number one, to bring together leaders from all parts of the country to discuss problems related to India. Then second, to form an action plan to get concessions from the British. In the moderate phase, Hindi we used to call it Naram Dal. During the first 20 years of the Congress, the moderate nationalists or moderates dominated the party. Surendranath Banerjee, Dilsha Bacha, Firoz Shah Mehta, and Gopal Krishna Gokhale were some important moderate leaders. They were moderate in their objectives and methods. They believed in constitutional methods and in methods of persuasion, request karna. They regularly sent petitions and resolutions to the government asking for freedom of speech and expression, expansion of welfare programs, promotion of education, recruitment of Indians to high post in the administration, more powers for the legislative councils and more Indian members in these councils, holding the civil service examinations in India and not just only in England, change in economic policies of the government so as to benefit Indian industries, a cut in military expenditure, stopping the drain of India's wealth to Britain. So you can see how many moderate demands are. Aisa kahin nahi tha ki aap Bharat chhod ke jao. Hame freedom chahiye speech and expression mein, welfare programs chalu kariye aur education promote kariye. Indians ko bhi high post milni chahiye administration mein. पावर मिलनी चाहिए लेजिस्लेटिव काउंसिल्स को और भी ज्यादा, सिविल सर्विस एग्जामिनेशन का सेंटर इंडिया में भी पढ़ना चाहिए, कट इन मिलिट्री एक्सपेंडिचर और इंडिया की वेल ट्रेन होकर के ब्रिटेन नहीं जानी चाहिए। द ब्रिटिश वे फेवरेबली इंक्लाइंड टूवर्ड्स द कांग्रेस ड्यूरिंग द अर्ली ईयर्स ऑफ इट्स फॉर्मेशन। Some British officials even attended Congress sessions and actively participated in the discussions. However, soon the British turned hostile towards it. They began to openly criticize the Congress. They realized that instead of becoming a means to contain the anger of the masses, the Congress was becoming the focus of Indian nationalism. Then comes a radical phase. So the failure of the moderates to achieve political reforms brought forth new trends in the Congress. The new group of leaders were called radicals, nationalists, or simply as radicals. इनको हम extremists भी कहते हैं या फिर गरम दल, in Hindi we used to call it. They were led by Lala Lajpat Rai, Bal Gangadhar Tilak, and Bipin Chandra Pal, popularly known as Lal Bal Pal. These leaders felt that the present ways of the Congress were ineffective. They were in favor of more radical objectives and methods. They called for strong political actions such as strikes, boycotts, mass demonstrations to spread awakening among the people to achieve political reforms. Bal Gangadhar Tilak called for the attainment of Swaraj. He declared, "Swaraj is my birthright and I shall have it." Then comes partition of Bengal, 1905. On 19 July 1905, the Viceroy Lord Curzon issued an order dividing the province of Bengal. In this, the majority of the population was Muslim, was separated from the rest of Bengal, which had a high percentage of Hindus. The reason given for the partition was that since Bengal was too big, it was important to divide it so that it could be administered efficiently. But the real reason for the partition was different. The national movement in Bengal was very strong. The partition was a deliberate attempt to weaken it by sowing seeds of disunity between Hindus and Muslims. The partition of Bengal was widely criticized. All sections of the people rose up in opposition. Demonstrations and public meetings were held throughout Bengal. People of all communities tied sacred threads on each other's wrist to express their solidarity and oneness. So the day the partition took effect, on the 16th October, was observed as a day of mourning. No business was conducted in the entire province. The national movement, instead of weakening, became more organized, radical and mass-based. Then Swadeshi and Bengal. The partition of Bengal gave rise to the two new methods of struggle, and that was Swadeshi and boycott children. Swadeshi means of one's own country. It was aimed at popularizing goods manufactured in India so that Indian industries could prosper. And the method of boycott focused on asking people to boycott, bahishkar kar liye, goods manufactured in Britain. This way, the British would stop treating India as a dumping ground for British goods. Starting from Bengal, the movement spread across the country. People boycotted British goods and began to use Indian-made goods. At some places, huge bonfires of foreign clothes were organized. And people who wore clothes made from cloth manufactured in Britain were criticized. Some worshipmen even refused to offer their services to such people. And students and women played an important role in these movements. They picked shops selling foreign goods to them. Then comes Surat split. The struggle against the partition of Bengal had temporarily united the moderates and the radicals. However, the difference in objectives and methods between the two were not easy to reconcile. At the Congress session in 1907 at Surat, there was a split between the two groups, the moderates and the extremists. The moderates began to control the Congress. Extremists or radicals are same children, so don't get confused. So the moderates began to control the Congress, and the radicals or extremists decided to function from outside. The two groups were reunited in the Congress session at Lucknow in 1916. Then comes the Morley Minto reforms. To pacify the moderate leaders, the government announced the Indian Council Act, which is also known as Morley Minto reforms. Morley Secretary of State and Minto Viceroy. Its main features were as follows. More members were to be inducted in the Central Legislative Council and the Provisional Legislative Councils. Then the system of separate electorates was introduced. The Muslims were grouped into separate constituencies from where only Muslim candidates could contest elections. So this Morley Minto reforms were just creating gap between the Hindus and Muslims children. So the Muslims were grouped into separate constituencies from where only Muslim candidates could contest elections. And this was done to pacify the leaders of the Muslim League, which had been formed a few years earlier. Then comes the revolutionary movement, Krantikari movement. The early years of the 20th century saw the growth of a revolutionary movement in Bengal, Punjab and Maharashtra. Young men advocated the use of force to expel the British out from India. Sorry. They formed secret societies to train their members in the use of firearms and explosives. Two of the most active revolutionary societies were the Abhinav Bharat Society in Maharashtra and the Anushilan Samiti in Bengal. The revolutionaries took to assassinating British officials. The Chapekar brothers assassinated two unpopular British officials in Maharashtra. In 1908, in Muzaffarpur, Khudiram Bose and Prafulla Chak threw a bomb at King's Fort, the district judge. In 1912, an attempt was made on the life of Viceroy Lord Hardinge. Some revolutionaries were also active abroad, especially in Europe and America. The Gadar Party was a revolutionary association. It published journals to spread revolutionary ideas. It also sent revolutionaries to organize uprisings in India. Some revolutionary leaders who worked from outside India were Lala Hardayal, Rasbihari Bose, Shyamaji Krishna Varma, Madam Bhikaji Kama, Mohammad Barakatullah, Soha Singh Bhakna, V.D. Savarkar and Ubaidullah Sindhi. The British used all means to suppress the revolutionary children. Sorry. Khudiram Bose was hanged. You can see the picture of Khudiram children on the screen. The Khudiram Bose was hanged. Arvinda Ghosh and Virinder Kumar Ghosh were put in jail. And some revolutionaries were sentenced to life imprisonment. The revolutionaries of this period became national heroes. So by the spirit of self-sacrifice, they inspired many people to join the national movement children. But however, it could not involve the masses. So what we have studied in this chapter, nationalism in India arose in the second half of the 19th century. The factors that led to it were discontent against British rule, the unification of the country, spread of modern education, the role played by the press, the policies of Lord Lytton and the Elbert Mill controversy. Then many political associations were formed in India after 1850. They consisted of educated Indians and had limited demands. Then the Indian National Congress was formed in 1885. The moderates dominated it during its early years. Later the radical plays an important role. The British partitioned Bengal in 1905 to weaken the national movement. This partition led to the Swadeshi and boycott movements. People boycotted British goods and started using goods made in India. Then the Morley Minto reforms introduced separate electorates for Muslims. It sowed the seeds of communalism. Then revolutionaries became very active during the first quarter of the 20th century, and they believed in using force to expel the British from India. That's all in this chapter, children. Read the chapter thoroughly, so it will help you to understand the chapter in a better way, and there will be MCQs from the book inside chapter. Okay, so you have to read the chapter thoroughly. That's all for today. Thank you and have a nice day.